It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard on a huge night of Premiership action. Celtic host St Mirren looking to build on their position at the top amidst that ongoing dispute with the Green Brigade. Philippe Clement's first away league game in charge of Rangers takes him to rain-soaked Dundee, but it is game on and managerless St Johnstone take on Kilmarnock, while Barry Robson and Stephen Naismith could be doing with wins against Motherwell and Livingston respectively. I'm Gordon Duncan, and joining me tonight you have Charlie Mulgrew and Hugh Keevins.
Well, there was a shift in the balance of power at the weekend at the top of the Premiership table. Celtic's 7-point lead became 5. Now, could there be another shift tonight? Because there are some very interesting matches. St Mirren go to Celtic Park, deserved of their third place in the league table. One of the form teams in a Premiership where form fluctuates dramatically. And Dundee, who host Rangers, have only lost one of their last 8 games. So, Charlie, a bit of room for manoeuvre tonight.
Yeah, there's some massive, massive games there. When you look at St Johnstone, Kilmarnock, huge game at the bottom of the league for St Johnstone to pick up points. Celtic again, not an easy game against St Mirren. St Mirren has proved they can be a difficult team to play against this year, and Rangers away to Dundee is a massive game. Then you look at Hearts Livingston. Them and Aberdeen both need a result as well. So a great fixture list tonight.
Love these midweeks. Plenty of talking points. We had a game last night in the top flight. The Championship was in full flow, and massive games tonight in the top flight as well. So 01419511025. What are you thinking? I always like to hear from fans going to games. I say it every week because I mean it. Are you heading along tonight? Are you on your way to Celtic Park? Are you on your way up to Dundee, Fir Park, wherever else you may be headed? Why not give us a call? Let us share the journey. You're probably stuck in traffic in this rain, so get the old hands free on and give us a call. If we're talking about the specific on the field issues, Celtic fans, who takes Rio Hatate's place? Are you sticking with Paolo Bernardo? Have you thought of something else? Can you see other areas of the squad that you would like rotated? Rangers fans, is it time now to give Cyril Dessers a rest from the beginning and bring in Danilo? Is Sam Lammers maybe nearing the stage he needs a rest out of the starting 11? Are there other players you think could come in and make an impact? If so, who are they? Give us a call. And the same goes for those other games as well. We're liking the looks of Fir Park and Tynecastle, and of course St Johnstone looking for a manager as well. Of course, with that added storyline, if you like, at Celtic Park tonight, with a ban from Celtic handed to the Green Brigade section of the stadium. So if you have any thoughts there, you can share them as well on the same number or on Twitter. So give us a call right now. Whilst you're getting in touch, let's whet your appetite. Let's set up some of the big games tonight, starting at Celtic Park. Let's hear what's going on there with Andrew Maclean.
Yeah, first against third tier, which I think will be music to the ears of both sets of fans. Celtic obviously continuing that unbeaten start to the Premiership season at the weekend with that draw against Hibs. But Brendan Rodgers said it, the tempo wasn't quite there for a lot of the game. Neither was the quality in the final third. They were miles off what they'd shown a week ago tonight in that game against Atletico Madrid, where they were fantastic. So they'll be looking to pick up that tempo tonight and try and trouble St Mirren. Some selection points of interest as well. You touched on Paolo Bernardo. Does he keep his place in for the injured Rio Hatate, or does Brendan Rodgers try someone else? Alistair Johnson as well, he's been training since he took that real sore one to the face at the weekend. Will be interesting to see if he starts this game as well. As for St Mirren, well, that 4-0 win against St Johnstone at the weekend, that was our biggest top flight win since they beat Celtic by the same scoreline almost 13 years ago. So they're on a real high. Striker Mikael Mandron talking in the build-up to this one. He thinks organisation will be the key if they want to get something tonight. He'll be hoping to play the Curtis Main role, who got a brace here in the last meeting between the clubs. That was that 2-2 draw in May, and as you mentioned as well, some off the field talking points as well. As we all know, Celtic have suspended the season tickets of the members of the Green Brigade until further notice. In their statement, they cited repeated incidents of unacceptable conduct. The fans group, they've responded today by saying they believe the ban has come as a result of their support for Palestine. That will certainly rumble on that one. It'll be interesting to see the impact it has on the game tonight, though. There's no doubt that that section of the home support are the loudest on any match day at Celtic Park. So interesting to see what the atmosphere at the game will be like tonight on what is a horrendous night here at Celtic Park. The rain swirling around the stadium at the moment as well. Still a wee while away from team news as well. I'll bring you that as soon as I get it.
Yeah, I was thinking that a couple of weeks ago. We asked you, Charlie, if you were missing playing, and you said not at all. So I'm going to guess that you're not going to miss wet, windy nights in November.
Absolutely not.
Did you ever think you would rather sit next to Hugh Keevins on a Wednesday night than go out and play in front of 60,000?
No, but I'm just looking at him now and I'm thankful to be here. That rain out there, I don't mind the rain, it was the wind. I hated playing the wind, especially like away games. Celtic Park kind of protected you a wee bit, or big stadiums protected you if you were like away games to Dundee or something like that. The corners are quite empty and the wind comes in, and the game can be horrible.
See, who knew? There's something reassuring about spending these dark winter nights in your company.
I see. I'm old enough to be his granddad. That's why he's comfortable in my presence.
That, like, it feels like a sort of warm encouragement from you, that sort of granddad.
Why are you trying to send my knee earlier? I'm closer with that chair.
I was just thinking when Andrew said it was 13 years since St Mirren beat Celtic.
I also had a quick look to see if he was involved that night, but he wasn't, so we'll let him off
the hook. Tony Mowbray. And by the time the Celtic bus had made the journey from Paisley to Celtic Park, they were outside with a banner saying Mowbray out, and the following day he was.
There we go. Right, what about Dundee then? It's game on, last we heard. Gabriel, same, I assume, no change up there?
Yes, Gordon, game is most certainly on. The pitch has made it through, although it is sodden in parts, especially around the goal mouth. Be interesting to see what happens when kickoff comes. But as you said earlier, it's Philippe Clement's first domestic away game as Rangers manager. His first taste of life on the road in the Scottish Premiership. And what should he expect? Well, as I said, it's a classic cold, wet and dark night here at Dens. The pitch is sodden, the fans will be up for it, and you bet Tony Doherty's side will be as well. Now, Clement's first 2 weeks have not been without their problems. They were poor for the majority of the weekend's game against Hearts. They required two late goals to win it, and he said yesterday that the injury crisis is a puzzle. It's the worst one he's ever seen. And Nico Raskin and John Suter are the latest players to join that injury list. They miss out today, but it has been a strong start for Clement, on paper at least, and he'll hope to build on that this evening. Perhaps we could see a first start in 2 months for Danilo. He returned from that facial injury. It kept him out for 2 months. He scored the winner on Sunday, of course, a great header. Kieran Dowell and Jose Cifuentes could also play. They've been out for a while too. Rangers know they've got to win tonight, keep the pressure on Celtic, keep the gap at no more than 5 points. But they face a Dundee side who've not lost at home since February, and they've made a great start to life in the top flight. They sit fifth and they're unbeaten in their last four. Tony Doherty will hope to take his first big scalp as a manager this evening. Now, the last time Rangers were up here, Aaron Ramsey scored a late equaliser before a Conor Goldson winner. That was for Giovanni Van Bronckhorst before the Europa League final. How much has changed since then? Seen a manager come and go, whilst Dundee have gone down and come back up again. It'll be really interesting when kickoff comes. I'll bring you team news first, though. That'll be in around half an hour.
Can't believe Gabriel just used Aaron Ramsey and Europa League final in the same sentence, as shudders ring out across one half, certainly, of Glasgow. But anyway, what are you thinking tonight? 01419511025. Massive games in the Premiership, big stories elsewhere. It should be a lively one on the phone. So let's get stuck in with Peter, who is in Paisley. How are you tonight, Peter?
I'm all right, Gordon. How yourself?
Can't complain. Cannot complain at all. What are you thinking then? With you're a Celtic fan, what's going into your thought process ahead of this one?
I've got a wee point for Charlie on the show. How do you, darling?
All right, Peter.
Hello.
I'm just wanting to know, see, because Giamakis is away, and when we played Madrid in the midweek game in the Champions League, and we didn't bring on Hove, I'm just wanting to know, do you think if Brendan Rodgers was there before Giamakis left, do you think he would still be there? And do you think he would be ahead of Ho, who I think isn't good enough to wear the jersey? And another wee quick thing and all, James Forrest, I love the guy, I love what he's done for the club, but he's just, I think he's just run out of legs. I think it's time for him to move on.
Right, so Celtic's attack very much in the spotlight. What do you think of Ho and the question Peter asked?
Okay, so against Atletico, my opinion was at that point in time he was looking for pace up front. He was Atletico were having a bit of the ball and he was looking for a bit of pace. Then he put Jamesy on, I think, when they had 10 men. And I think it says a lot about Ho, to be honest with you. I think if Giamakis was there, Giamakis would definitely come on the pitch. Whether he would have been there if Rodgers had been the manager or not is really hard to tell, because we don't know how strongly he wanted to leave. And we do know it's clear that when you show any hint of not wanting to be there under Ange Postecoglou, he doesn't stand in anybody's way, doesn't even come close to standing in anybody's way. If you don't want to be there, you're gone. So whether Brendan Rodgers would have had better man management skills or better persuasion skills to keep Giakoumakis at the club or to assure him that he would get a lot more game time. Nobody knows, but what we definitely know is he's missing at Celtic. They'll probably be looking at January for a new striker, definitely, because Kyogo can't do it all himself. And I think that you're seeing James Forrest and Mikey Johnson coming up front. You know that they probably are, because that's not their most comfortable position. I think they are they will be looking for a striker.
The drop between Kyogo Furuhashi and Doe is too great. He's raw. I agree with Peter on the line. I don't think he's up to playing for Celtic. And they should have bought in the summertime window someone who filled that gap between Kyogo and Doe. And they will do in the January window because it's necessary.
I think we've seen enough of O to know that for sure. And I accept there's a counter argument there which says, well, maybe there's a reason we haven't seen more of him, which I, you know, again accept that because Brendan Rodgers sees him and so on. You think, you know, have we seen enough to make that?
It's difficult for the likes of O, in my opinion, because he's more of a target man, strong type of striker, and Celtic don't play that way. I mean, you could argue,
I suppose so with Giakoumakis.
You could argue Giakoumakis is like that as well. But he seemed to have more ability, more instincts to score goals. Recently a chance fell to O, and he had a couple of goals at it against Hearts and just didn't look like a natural finisher that gets in the right areas, whereas Giakoumakis was a finisher. He would come on and score goals and make a difference and push to get a start, whereas O doesn't seem to be close to getting a start at all.
If you don't look like a natural finisher, then chances are you're not a natural finisher. But anyway, I am certain that in 2 months' time when the window opens, the first thing that Brendan Rodgers will do will be to go after someone who can back up Kyogo, can take the place of Kyogo, and I'm afraid O can do neither of those things.
What's the script? Elaborate with this opinion on James Forrest, Peter, because a lot of people obviously said it at the weekend, you know, should we, and on last midweek, you know, we're still turning to James Forrest in 2023. That was the type of phrase. But I wonder if that stuff, you know, has maybe been held against him a bit. Was he any worse than anyone else at the weekend? Did he not actually look quite bright when he came on?
Well, I know he had a chance to hit the bar and all that, but I just feel as though when it's just Hugh's head, Cole, it just isn't getting a look in. James Forrest, you would think Cole would come on, but every time Cole comes on, he's a liability. He gets booked for daft challenges at certain areas of the field or the park. It's just crazy. And I just think Forrest just needs to go. Mikey Johnson's another one. I think he's done. I think he's done at Celtic. And I just think we need a massive clear out, and I need to see a decent striker that far to back up for Kyogo. Because if Kyogo was to play, Celtic wouldn't be 4 points or whatever as ahead of the Rangers in it.
But Brendan Rodgers has gone public this week and said that there will have to be comings and goings.
Well,
and
more goings than comings.
Exactly, yeah. Squad's too heavy. But he also went out of his way to talk about James Forrest and his level of fitness and how fast he is, etc., etc. And I took that to be a boost for James Forrest. Not that he needs one. He's been a mega player for Celtic and has the medals to prove it. But I don't think you just throw him under the bus like that. He ought to have won the game for Celtic at Easter Road. He was in a great position. He hit the bar rather than scored. Unfortunate that happens. But Brendan Rodgers is not of a mind to, as Peter said, move him on. He's going to be there and he's on a fairly lengthy contract as
I'm quite nosy. I love all that stuff about testing and who's the quickest and all that. And Brendan Rodgers did say he's the quickest winger in terms of a one-off sprint. He's up there with Maeda, he said. Maybe not able to do it as repeatedly as Maeda does. I mean, you've played with James Forrest. What do you make of his role now and how some of the Celtic fans are seeing that?
When Celtic fans see somebody that's been there for 10 to 12 years coming in and being in playing in the striker role, naturally fans like to see, not just Celtic fans, any fans like to see a big name signing, or they would much prefer somebody like O showed something they'd never seen before, because they're used to seeing James Forrest in the wing and they kind of know what they're getting from him. They're not the happiest. We've seen him as striker, and I think that if he scores that game at the weekend and they win the game, everybody's saying what a genius decision that is for Brendan Rodgers and trying Jamesy up front. And that was his original position when he first came into the Celtic team, I think. He played in that forward area, and But he is a winger, Jamesy. He knows he's a winger, but it just shows credit to Jamesy. He'll do anything he can for the team. He'll play up front. He's a good finisher and he's got pace. And I think when he thinks about a striker, he probably thinks about somebody that can hold the ball in and somebody that can sprint and show in behind. And I think that's when he thinks about Jamesy. But he's a great player, Jamesy, there's no doubt about it. And I'm not surprised that he's one of the quickest wingers there, because if not the quickest, because he's really powerful over a short distance.
Okay, thank you, Peter. Food for thought there, Celtic fans. Are you agreeing or disagreeing? Maybe you get your thoughts in specifically on tonight's lineup and anything else that's going on there tonight. What about Sean, though, who's got Rangers on his mind? Sean, what are you thinking tonight?
Hey, how you doing, mate? How you doing, guys? You all good?
How are you doing?
No, I was just wanting to say, so it was regarding fans saying Tav should be stripped to the captaincy. So, in my opinion, like, he sets goals up, he scores goals all the time. It's like, can I, for example, with Man United, you know, people are mourning Bruno Fernandes is captain with him, he should be stripped of that. But then who do you swap him with? If you strip Tav of the captaincy, who are you actually going to make captain in that Rangers team? The guy sets goals up, scores goals all the time. If you take him out of the team, it's going to be a big miss. And then there's other players, who are you going to swap James Tavernier with as for captain, kind of thing? That's what I was kind of wanting your thoughts on.
Well, I mean, going into tonight, Hugh, maybe the weekend was a perfect example of the different ways, and Charlie's captained many teams, you know, of you can sort of lead. You get a guy that misses a penalty but shows enough bottle to take another one and score it and sets up the other. It's just this ongoing debate that seems to never end around James Tavernier.
I think some of these debates, they become a cliche. And Rangers, even under Philippe Clement, they have not been perfect. Far from it. There were moans and groans and boos at Ibrox last Sunday. But Tavernier came to the fore when Rangers needed him, and he has made a habit of doing that. I know I asked a caller outright last week, who do you want then? He said Jack Butland. Now, Butland has been the shining light for Rangers out of the summertime buying, which has largely been poor. Butland is the one success, undiluted success. However, Tavernier has not done anything which would allow Philippe Clement to even think about stripping him of the captaincy.
It just shows you how fine the margins are. He missed a penalty and they're 7 minutes away for getting beat 1-0 for Hearts and not capitalising on Celtic drawing at Easter Road. So I think that we would have had callers on again screaming for his captaincy to be taken off him if he hadn't, the ref hadn't given a penalty. So he goes up and shows real captain qualities there by taking leadership and taking the penalty. He could easily have passed that on to somebody else, and then he gets the ball and crosses it, and an unbelievable ball right onto Danilo's head for the winner. So it just shows the fine margins, and that's what it is, the team like Celtic and Rangers. But he stepped up again and showed why he is captain, and there's all sorts of ways to lead. We speak about that before. There's shouters, there's screamers, there's people that have a go at people, there's people that speak a lot, and then there's people that just lead by how they play and how they never give up. They play a lot of minutes and they score at big moments and get assists.
You captained Blackburn, didn't you? You captained Scotland on occasion. Yeah. Did we put too much emphasis on it? What's it like being the guy who's got the armband? I mean, do you start thinking about all these things differently?
You need to. When I first got given the captaincy anywhere I was, my main thing that I come back to was just be myself, because the reason you were asked to be captain is clearly because of the way you were acting. So I just tried to always be myself and be the person that I was, and that's the way I tried to be. The season that I was given captaincy, I scored 14 goals from centre half, and I took the penalties, and so a
that's
lot
a
of the
ludicrous
week.
Return, isn't it?
Yeah, I missed a penalty in the last day to score 15.
Still
haunts me. I think that was some sort of record. Potentially somebody mentioned that Aidan Flint had scored something like 50 or 14, and that would have beat the record. But anyway,
what's the worst thing about being a captain?
The worst thing about being a captain is it's probably the stuff off the pitch. You know that? It's like everybody comes to you to go and deal with the manager and deal with things that maybe the Christmas night out. I mean, that's not the worst. That's not the worst thing to organise.
But something you would quite like.
It was all right. I wasn't. But you need. You can hand out jobs as well. So you get somebody to do the fines. You'll be somebody that collects the fines in. A couple of years I've done it, collecting the fine money. It's good because you don't really need to pay fines as well. You don't
get away with that.
Well, you don't really have to, but you're taking the money in, so
that's an abusive position.
Aye, well, sometimes you've got to do what you've got to do.
I don't know you that well, but just from what I've learned, I just can't imagine you organising tickets.
Oh,
I think you'd be terrible at that.
No, I wasn't great with that. To be fair, that wasn't really the captain's job though. When I done it, there'd be somebody at the club that would sort the tickets out.
Sean, we've got distracted in terms of the team tonight. Sean, from a Rangers perspective. So much. The only thing we've spoke about more than James Tavernier's captaincy is Cyril Dessers and Sam Lammers' form. Is it time that someone else came in and started matches, or do you think they'll both still get the nod from the off?
Nah, in my opinion, mate, it's time, mate. They've got to change. Danilo's obviously proved his form. Like, every time he's played, he's kind of performed. Obviously, due to injury, he's kind of not been able to prove his like his place kind of thing. But like he's come on. At the second end of the start of second half, the last game, came on and scored the last minute goal, obviously, and in his game against St Johnstone as well, he scored the goal before the injury. So I think he obviously deserves his chance as number nine rather than playing out on the left. But I'd like to see the boy McCausland as well playing over Lammers kind of thing, do you know what I mean? Or somebody else anyway. Like the two of them have had umpteen chances and there's obviously nothing happening to it. And that seems to be like a kind of main factor that a lot of fans are moaning about regarding Dessers and Lammers. So I feel as if the night's a kind of chance where somebody else deserves a chance to kind of prove their point, to kind of play and show what they've got to play. Do you know what I mean?
Well, we'll find out soon. Thank you to Sean, 01419511025. And if you call us right now, there's a good chance we'll speak to you next.
You are the voice of Scottish football. Call 01419511025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Hugh Keevins and Charlie Mulgrew are here, and that break ended much earlier than I anticipated, so there we are. Lots going on tonight, many big games across the country, looking for you to get in touch and share your thoughts, team selection, suggestions, importance of the fixture. There are obviously other storylines. I'm looking forward to getting round to St Johnstone's managerial search, the pressure that is on the likes of maybe Barry Robson, Stephen Naismith. I think it's safe to say they could be doing with a win as well. And of course, Hugh, there is that knock-on effect at Celtic Park tonight, because the Green Brigade have hit back at Celtic, calling the club shameful after it was banned from all games. Last night's show, we spoke about the rap sheet, if you like. Now, Celtic say this is due to basically, like I say, you know, a rap sheet, various issues around safety and behaviour. Now, the timing of it has led to, an understandable level of cynicism, and the Green Brigade believe this is due to their solidarity with Palestine and everything that's going on at the moment, whereas Celtic are being consistent in saying that it's actually to do with various behavioural issues. Either way, it's resulted in a ban. The Green Brigade have hit back today, and you wonder where it goes from here.
Well, what we have now is a full-scale internal war between a section of the club support and those who run the club. I have no intention whatsoever of discussing a humanitarian tragedy in the Middle East, because this is not the forum for that discussion. We all have our private views on what's going on there, but you're asking me about a football club and a renegade group of supporters. Part of their statement today from the Green Brigade says that they have no regrets about bypassing internal security. Well, I'm sorry, but you just can't bypass security. The clue is in the title. The opposite of security is insecurity, and you cannot create an insecure situation inside football grounds or outside football grounds when there are other people potentially going to be caught up in it. Celtic have to meet with the Green Brigade. They have to see if there is a mature resolution possible to what is going on now, because what is going on now is a massive distraction for the players. They may not discuss it in the dressing room, but they'll be aware of an area of the ground being unoccupied now. They'll be aware of, I would imagine, a drop in noise levels during games. What's going on is unhealthy for the football club. And you either come to a mature resolution, or you come to the conclusion that you're better off closing that part of the ground, returning season ticket money to those who have paid for them, and going to your waiting list of supporters and allow them to occupy those seats.
Is it a complex issue though? Because like everything, I was going to say in Scottish football, but sometimes everything in the world now, without getting too deep, people will have you believe it's like this binary issue where it's one thing or the other, and you either have to be for the Green Brigade or you have to be against them. When it's no situation's ever like that. There's always a bit in the middle where you can maybe acknowledge clearly the atmosphere that is brought, maybe acknowledge some of the good charitable causes that are covered, maybe look at the ways that some of the spectacle can boost the club's profile in different ways, and acknowledge that there are shortcomings as well. It just feels like frustratingly, like every single issue, it just gets boiled right down to, are you for or are you against? And I think we even saw that on the phones a little bit last night.
Again, I have no intention of overlooking the charitable works that they do, and they are to be commended for that. I would also point out that Celtic's own charity foundation provides much needed help to a wide variety of causes, and they're not to be overlooked in that direction either. My belief, personal belief, fans don't go to Celtic Park for the most part to take part in a political seminar. Every passing cause, whether it's playing Lazio and the protest against fascism in Italy, whether it's Palestine and what is tragically going on there. Ange Postecoglou said a wonderful thing last week as manager of Tottenham, who draw a percentage of their support from London's Jewish community. And he said that in these scenarios, football clubs have to provide what they have always provided, a sense of one place where people can escape what's going on and go and unite behind their football team. Therefore, I think Celtic are trying to provide a very successful football team and a place where people can go and find a haven from humanitarian tragedy.
Well, let's get back to things that were maybe, I was going to say, more of our area of expertise, but I don't know if I've got any of them either, because we've got team news from both of those big games. We've got some callers lined up as well. So let's go Andrew Maclean from Celtic Park. What can you tell us?
Yeah, well, one of the areas of focus that people probably weren't thinking about was centre-back for Celtic, and that is a big point of interest tonight because Cameron Carter-Vickers is not in the squad for Celtic at all tonight. He drops out of the squad. Paolo Bernardo, he drops to the bench, and so does Dyson Maeda. So Nat Phillips comes in for them. David Turnbull is in as well, and you were talking about him earlier on, James Forrest gets a start for Celtic also. So it's Joe Hart in goal, the back four, Alistair Johnson, Nat Phillips, Liam Scales and Greg Taylor. The midfield three, Callum McGregor, Matt O'Reilly and David Turnbull. It will then be Lewis Palma and James Forrest either side of Kyogo. The substitutes, Bain, Yang, Holm, Navrotsky, Oh, Iwata, Bernardo, Maeda and Ralston. Also have a St Mirren team for you as well. It's Zach Henning in goal for them. The back three, Marcus Fraser, Alex Gogic and Richard Taylor. The wing backs, Ryan Strain and Scott Tanzer. The two central midfielders, Caelan Boyd-Munce and Mark O'Hara. The supporting act up top, Greg Kilty and Conor McMenamin, with Toyosi Olasanya leading the line for them. The substitutes are Minsky, Bolton, Dunn, Small, Flynn, Jameson, Mandron, Grieve and Nakmani.
Interesting team news, Charlie Mulgrew, your area of expertise, Celtic's back four. Well, obviously I was going to say you're surprised, but clearly there's a reason that Cameron Carter-Vickers,
it must have been an injury that nobody knew about. But I thought Bernard might have started, but he didn't. Turnbull comes in, done well at the start of the season in one or two games. So
it's a big night for him. It feels like there's a lot of Celtic fans increasingly not convinced that he can take Rio Hatate's place. I'm sure he'll be out to prove that he can.
Yeah, he'll be right in there trying to get himself a start in the team, because he's a big miss, Hatate, and Turnbull will be looking to take over and try and play in the Champions League and get game time. James Forrest back to his natural wing position. Big game for him as well to try and put his stamp and get in the team.
I've always thought that tonight would be a difficult game for Celtic. And
excellent, aren't they?
Yeah, without doubt. They go there, one of the form teams. You know, Celtic have had six away games and only dropped 2 points. Great record. And they haven't lost a game at Celtic Park this season. Great record. But it's not convincing at the moment. It wasn't convincing against Hibs. And I think they're bang up against it tonight with this St Mirren side. And now that they've lost Cameron Carter-Vickers, Hatate's lost for the remainder of 2023. And Maeda, you know, I know he had issues with his contact lenses at the weekend, but I assume that's not why he's out.
Nothing worse.
But I think it's an even more difficult game now, given the side that Brendan Rodgers has had to put out.
I think they have been convincing, Hugh. I think that we're looking at the Hibs game most recently and it was 0-0, but if you look back to the Atletico Madrid game, Celtic were unbelievable in long spells of that game, and then the Hearts game at Tynecastle, Celtic were brilliant. So I think they're in a good place at the moment, although there'll be a couple of changes. They'll look to get back right on the boat here and a real strong performance, hopefully, and get the result. Albeit St Mirren are a hard team to play against, because they're drilled in the way they play. They sit in a shape and they press. They all know when to press and they all know when to kind of sit and wait for the counter-attack. So Celtic need to be on top form tonight to get the goal.
Tongue slightly in cheek, because as we said earlier, James Forrest has been a brilliant player, so it's not a slight on him. I've got this image in my head, if you're a St Mirren fullback and you see no dies in Maida, you think, brilliant.
Yeah.
Good. I cannot be bothered chasing him around all night. But anyway, we're going to give you team news when we get full team news from Dens Park in just a minute or two. Let's bring in Stoddy, who's on the line. Stoddy, how are you?
How are you doing? All right, boys?
Good. How are you, more importantly?
No bad, mate. No bad.
What are you thinking?
I was just driving home here, and I think it was one of your first calls. He was going about Celtic need a clear out with James, like you said, James A. Forrest and Hingman. Do you seriously think that if Brendan Rodgers thought they couldn't do a job for Celtic, they'd still be in the squad? It's crazy to think. Mm-hmm. Charlie touched on it there when he says how good we played against Atletico Madrid and then Hearts, obviously. Well, we're outstanding, and then they draw one game against Hibs and all of a sudden Celtic need a clear. I just think it's crazy.
Is it a numbers thing though as well, Stoddy? Brendan Rodgers said it's the squad's too big, you know, and Forrest is maybe a bit more of a debatable one, but you know, guys like Kwon signed and never seen looking at the bench tonight, still no Lager Bielka on that bench. You know, there are players there that are just not contributing.
But I think like say James DeForest and Mikey Johnson, they'll do for Scotland. The players you just mentioned there, get rid of them. The players like James DeForest, Mikey Johnson, stuff like that, they'll do for Scotland.
Well, Mikey Johnson's now an Irish international.
Six times an Irish international.
Right. And anyway, James Forrest.
I think he means in the SPL, don't you? Stoddy. In the SPL games.
Oh, right. I thought you meant the national team. Sorry, Stoddy.
No.
Sorry. Well, Hugh, what do you think? Stoddy's defending some of these players, but like we said, there is clearly a numbers issue for Brendan Rodgers.
Yeah. I mean, the manager can't be any more specific unless he actually tells you who's going. The squad's too big for him. The players who have been brought in the summertime are not doing it for him, by and large. And there's going to have to be change. There's no need for anyone to take the huff over this, to take offence. Players will be going because Brendan Rodgers thinks that they're not going to make it under him.
Stoddy, Hugh Keevins thinks that Celtic team tonight is maybe giving St Mirren a bit more of a chance. We know he's a very cynical, negative man at times. Do you share his concerns?
I just heard the team news there, but I think we should be all right. A wee early goal and we'll be sorted for tonight. I'll say 2-3-0.
I'm not sure.
You would say that.
I did say it on Saturday and you all
right.
Laughed at me.
I know, but that means that you're not due another one for like 6 months.
Well, we shall see, Charlie. We shall see.
Does it feel like there's a bit of an addition then for Rio Hatate's spot? Because Bernardo came on for him obviously in Europe, then played again. David Turnbull gets the nod tonight. I know Celtic fans were quite excited by bits of what they saw against home. He then got sent off. We've not really seen him again. Is that open?
Yeah, it looks like it is. You can tell by the team selection tonight it's open. And David Turnbull will know that. He'll know that the manager's not 100% convinced with Bernard. So he'll be looking to take his chance tonight. And he's a goal threat. I think that's a big part as well. He does hit shots. He does have that bit of flair in the final third. So, yeah, it's definitely a spot that's ready. And I think Brendan Rodgers shown in the past that he's ruthless. Mm-hmm. If somebody's not doing a job, he doesn't.
Go back to game number one, Charlie. Celtic at home to Ross County, and Turnbull was preferred to Rio Hatate at that particular point and scored two goals. That's the David Turnbull that Brendan Rodgers needs and wants tonight.
I've got this sort of theory, right? I don't know if it's because I'm conditioned of being a fan of a so-called wee team. See, when you think that you've got a chance at places like Celtic Park, they're the ones that sometimes come to bite you on the backside. However, I do wonder if St Mirren will ignore my theory, because why would you care about that, and think, well, do you know what? Cameron Carter-Vickers is out. There's no Reo Hitati. Celtic are at war with an element of their own fans. Maybe there's a chance there. And maybe my theory comes out to be right, and it's 4-0 Celtic.
Go back to the other Saints, St Johnstone, who are so bad, they've had to bin the manager and have 4 points all season long. They went to Celtic Park and got a goalless draw.
You'll see, I mean, you've seen it from both sides, Charlie.
I think that day was a turning point for Celtic. I think when they get the 0-0 draw, Celtic then realised a lot of the messages they were getting from Brendan Rodgers, they really started to understand them, and it was a real turning point. Celtic from then, if you look at their performances from then, they've been really, really good. So I think that the big thing tonight is St Mirren will spend a long, long time in their own half without the ball. It's when Celtic can get the chances and score them. And if you score nice and early, you score in the first half, then St Mirren need to come out a wee bit and try and get their cell a goal. Otherwise, they'll spend long spells stuck in their half in the final third, because Celtic, that's what they do to teams, and especially teams that don't press high.
You wonder if there's a team that can pull that off, though. It might well be St Mirren. We're in for a good one, I think. Thank you to Stoddy. We'll get team news from Dundee next and speak to James, but let me run this past you.
Win £250,000. Clyde One.
Yes, Friday's getting closer, which means you're running out of time to win £250,000. We're going to try and give you that money in time for the weekend, teaming up with our stations from across the UK. All you need to do is enter now to win £250,000. We're talking life-changing money here. We guarantee every penny paid out to one winner, and if it is you, the cash will be paid into your bank account straight after the call. Text YES to 61025. Text or £2 plus your standard network rate. You can enter online at the website, which costs £2, or call 0330 880 4523, and those calls are charged at a standard rate. All the rules for this Bauer Media Audio UK competition are on the website. It's over 18s only, and the lines close at 5pm on Friday, when Gemma Atkinson will make the call. There's no phrase or amount to remember. You don't have to pick up within five rings. So for your chance to win £250,000, which is a sensational amount of money, text YES to 61025.
141-951-1025. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Lots of interesting team news to bring you around. You're looking at St Johnstone's first team line since sacking Stephen Maclean. Big games at Fir Park and Tynecastle and all that sort of stuff. So lots going on there. But let's get to which the artist formerly known as Dens Park, which is now called Gabriel.
Oh, Gordon, I read it on the way and I've already forgotten.
Oh, my goodness.
They're actually officially calling it this new name at Dens Park, I'll tell you that.
Uh-huh.
So Dens Park is still part of it.
Have you not been
name.
Listening to Beat the Pundit? It would have been on there at some point. The Scott Foam Stadium.
Scott Foam, I've got it. I'm being pointed to it right now. Scott Foam Stadium, thank you very much.
Just
Scott Foam
off
at Dens Park.
Anyway, team news. Who's playing?
Team news. Big team news here, Gordon, and that's that Danilo leads the line for Philippe Clement's side for the first ever time. It's his first start in 2 months since that bad facial injury he had up at St Johnstone. He's one of four changes from that 2-1 comeback win over Hearts at the weekend. In with him come Balogun, Jack and Wright, whilst Nico Raskin is out of the squad altogether, along with Ben Davis, which is a surprise. We didn't expect that. Todd Cantwell and Cyril Dessers also drop to the bench. Now, just before I go through the full 11, security is saying there may be a 20-minute delay to kickoff. The Rangers team bus reportedly struggling to reach the stadium. Nothing confirmed yet, Gordon, but I'll come back to you on that. Important to stress that for any fans going to the game. But a quick run through of the Rangers 11. Jack Butland in goal, a back four of James Tavernier, Connor Goldson, Leon Balogun and Ridvan Yilmaz. It'll be John Lundstrom and Ryan Jack in midfield. Scott Wright on one wing with Abdullah Simmet on the other. Sam Lammers will play behind Danilo. The substitutes are McCrory, Dessers, Cantwell, Cifuentes, Dowell, Sterling, Barisic, King and McCausland. As I've been speaking to you as well, the Dundee team has finally dropped. I'll have a quick run through of that as well. It'll be Carson in goal, Beck, Shaughnessy, Tiffany, Bakayoko, Lamy, McCowan, Boateng, Donnelly, Silla and Portales make up their 11.
Yeah, looks like that kickoff will be delayed. We'll keep you up to speed. James in Hamilton, I am so sorry. You have been hanging on this line since Hugh Keevins celebrated his 40th birthday. That's how long it will feel for you. So my apologies. Take it away.
Ah, it's fine. Listen, it's at Hamilton, no Hamilton, formerly known as.
Ah, honestly, I don't even know what's going on in here, James. I just blame someone else for these things. So anyway, you're a Rangers fan though, yes?
Yeah.
Right, we've got that much right. Good. Carry on.
I'm just on the phone just a wee bit about management style, because you mentioned it earlier to one of the callers, just to say that it's, for Philippe already, it's been a wee bit turbulent, and it's been up and down. And one of the things that sort of struck me in the sort of press conference earlier in the week for Dundee was that Ben Davies, who lives in your team news there, doesn't seem to be playing.
I did wonder that, James, why did the press conference?
He actually, maybe this is the reason for it, actually, because he was asked, like, what has the manager done, you know, when coming into this new role? And obviously we seem to be going a little bit more up the way rather than, you know, down the way. So we're not losing games. We are, thankfully, getting points on the board, which is good. And he said, hadn't really done much and not really made wholesale changes. But one of the things he did point out with, which I thought was interesting, was that he had this better relationship with players. Like, he speaks directly with players, he shares these thoughts with players, he speaks to them, right? And I remember, let me cash my mind back to when Beale first came in, he was asked this question constantly: how will your relationship change with the players between going from a coach to a manager? And I remember him saying something along the lines of, he's nobody's friend, or he kept himself as a distance, he was a disciplinarian in the training park, and he never really had any sort of, you know, communication with players directly type of thing. And I wonder whether or not that's the case when he transitioned into the management role. You know, did he carry that way on? Because it sounds like maybe in the modern game, and obviously, Charlie, it's probably a question to you, if more players need that personal touch, you know what I mean? That sort of speaks directly, you know, someone they can go to, someone they can talk and communicate to, and obviously share their problems, and give them that sort of confidence boost. That was one of the ones that Ben mentioned, was a confidence boost. So I guess the question is, you know, what sort of management style do professional players in the modern game really prefer? Is it that distant manager or the one more closer?
I don't think it ever changes in life, and football is no different. I think you need to have a connection with your players. You need to know, they need to know that you care. That can be in different ways. It doesn't need to be that you have to be their mates and sit down and talk to them and crack jokes with them and all that. I think they just need to know that you've got their back, you're behind them. Certain things like coming out in the press and backing them at certain times, having small chats with them. It could be something as much as just a pat in the back or a well done. I think that you need to have these connections with players, because it's all, they talk about tactics and they talk about philosophies, and there's a lot of that talk in football now. But what will never leave is management of players and management of people. And I think that no matter what philosophy and what tactical ideas you have in the game, your players will never carry them out if you don't have a connection with them and they don't feel that you care about them. And
is everybody different though? Is that the ultimate challenge? Because yeah. I think you've said before on here that you liked being, you didn't mind getting a kick up the backside, yeah, basically.
But well, if you go right into the deepness of that, is I liked that because I knew it came from a place of care. So I knew, my dad told me straight, used to tell me straight, would tell you no in certain terms, but you knew it came from a place of care. Neil Lennon was exactly the same. So I think as long as you've got a connection and as long as you know the person tells you that when you do something well, they tell you they've done something well, but also they tell you straight when you don't. And I think within truth, that's a big way to get a connection with people. If they know that you're telling the truth and you know that you're being honest, then there's a trust there. And that's how you get you get the best out of people, by having that connection and having that trust. And to go back to your question, I hope I've helped understand that if Michael Beale decides he stands off and I'm going to do this, if that's not your natural personality, and I'm not saying it is or it isn't, but I think you also need to be yourself. I don't think you can copy anybody else. You need to be you, because your players will sniff that out and see right through it.
I don't think there's any great mystique here. Philippe Clement is a different calibre of manager from Michael Beale. Serial title winner in Belgium, which is a very good standard. And quite simply, a far more experienced and far better manager than Michael Beale. Michael Beale had 24 games in management at QPR and then came here. Rangers fell for Michael Beale. And now they are still living with Michael Beale's misjudgments, and they were mainly made on the transfer market. So in every press conference he ever had, Michael Beale told you a special relationship he had with every individual at Rangers. I don't know whether it was true or false. What I do know is this man, Clement, is a different calibre of manager.
Speaking of recruitment, James, Cyril Dessers and Sam Lammers have been the main whipping boys, if you like, amongst the new signings. One of them has kept their place, it's Sam Lammers. The other has dropped out to be replaced by Danilo. What do you make of that?
Yeah, it's obviously really happy that Danilo gets his start. I think, you know, he still has a bit to prove, but, you know, he looks like a busy person over the park, which is good to see. He looks like he wants to get involved, and he looks eager as well. Like, he has the same thing that Fashion had that we all liked, which he plays with a smile in his face. And, you know, Kyogo has the same thing, and I'm sure Celtic fans are dear to him because of it. It's like, you know, when you can see people enjoying being in the park, you know what I mean? And that in itself is good. You know, Dessers and Lammers, again, just going back to that Beale situation and being a new manager, it's being a new manager in any sort of profession, you always feel you need to be this stoic person, you know what I mean? Like, you know, distance yourself and make your authority known type of thing. And I think, to be honest, if I'm being really fair, maybe he did leave them out to dry a little bit, whereas I feel like Clement, you know, with his experience, like Hugh says there, can bring them in and, you know, give them a little bit of shelter from the, you know, the criticism they are getting. But let's be fair, you know, it's not unfounded criticism. Mm-hmm. I'm actually surprised Lammer starts today, surprised Cantwell's on the bench alongside the young boy as well out wide. So, yeah, I think, to be honest, more than anything, it's probably a good move that Philippe's came in for Dessers and Lammers, because I hope that he will have, like we've already seen today, or well, not today, in recent events, you know, he brings players when they come off and substitute them. He talks to them, you know, he explains, you know, doubt, I don't know what he's saying, but he's obviously having some form of communication, right?
Yeah, you'd like to
think
so.
You never saw that before, and Rangers fans pick up on it quite a lot.
Yeah, just quickly, because we are nearing the end of this part, are you surprised Sam Lammers kept his place?
Very. It's a great old Scottish cliche when you bring in a player from abroad and you spend a few million pounds on him. But can he do it on a wet Wednesday in Dundee? Well, we'll find out tonight
at the Scott Foam Stadium, which will not kick off on time, Gabriel.
No, Gordon, it won't. Both Rangers and Dundee have tweeted to confirm the delay to kick off. It's due to severe traffic disruption. Turnstiles will be open as normal for both sets of fans. We have no confirmed kickoff time yet, although we're expecting around a 20-minute delay. I'll let you know the latest as we get it.
Oh, needless to say, I hope it's nothing serious, but Charlie Mulgrew will testify that you don't miss that drive into Dundee, do you?
No,
he's happy to be done with that. But he faces a totally different type of stress in the form of this.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
It is Beat the Pundit time. You have until 7, so give us a call on 01419511025, and it could be you who plays next.
Tackle the headlines. 1-4-1-9-5-1-1-0-2-5.
Clyde 1 Super Scoreboard. Hugh Keevins and Charlie Mulgrew are here. There is a lot going on. Big Premiership games up and down the country. Celtic against St Mirren, two teams in good form, it has to be said, at this early part of the season. Of course, there's that ban from the Green Brigade, which adds an off-field element to it. Rangers fans heading to Dundee, the kickoff's been delayed there. An interesting team selection from Philippe Clement as well. We're going to get to St Johnstone's first game without a manager. You never know, we've got a young, aspiring coach in the studio. I wonder if he'll be throwing his CV in. Not you.
No.
Don't look at me like that.
I ruled myself out.
Big night for the likes of Aberdeen and Hearts, who could probably be doing with a win. So we'll get as much of that in as we can, but we need your help. 01419511025. Let's play this first.
Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun.
For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football.
Charlie Mulgrew was telling us he's got a taste for this Beat the Pundit stuff. He won his last outing he's keen for more. You've just seen and done it all, really. You've had zeros, probably. You've had tens.
I've never had a zero, to be fair. I've been rubbish, but I've never had a zero. But I'm winning. But I'm winning in a very, very scruffy way, Charlie.
Yeah, that was Mullet my win last week, but I'm raring to go today.
You get a 10 out of 10 this season.
Yep.
Sensational, okay. Honestly. Don't get me wrong, that's not his usual level, but you know, we'll see. Right, heads it is Hugh, tails it will be Charlie Mulgrew. And it's tails, he's got his wish. Charlie Mulgrew against James in Springburn. How's it going, James?
I'm very well, thanks. How's yourself?
Not bad at all. James, you're a Celtic fan. Are you giving yourself more chance of a win than Celtic tonight, or is that just a silly question?
No, silly question, of course.
Backing his team over him, over his own ability. Let's see what we've got here, James. I'm sure you're familiar with the format, but what we'll do first is give Charlie some greatest hits radio to listen to so that he can't hear. And we'll then get 30 seconds for you, James, where you answer as many as you can. And if you want to pass and move on to the next one, that's absolutely fine, okay?
Okay, that's fine.
Right, let's go. Your time starts now. Who was the only Scotsman to score in the 2-2 draw between Hibs and Ross County last night?
Jordan White.
Who's bottom of the Scottish Championship?
Abrof.
Who's the only player in the Rangers squad in their second stint at the club? Scrap that, let's move on. Matt O'Reilly signed from Celtic for which club?
MK Dons.
Name any of the two Scots currently managing in the English Championship.
Pass.
Before Stephen Maclean, who was the last manager to lose their job in the Scottish Premiership?
Michael Beale.
Who used to play their home games at Muirton Park? I'll give you an extra question, I'll reveal why in a minute. Quick. Muirton Park.
Pass.
Okay, let's bring back Charlie. Can you hear us, Charlie? Got us?
Yes.
Loud and clear. Good. Right, you ready?
Yes, let's
Same go. Set of questions. 30 seconds on the clock. And your time starts now. Who was the only Scotsman to score in the 2-2 draw between Hibs and Ross County last night?
White.
Who's bottom of the Scottish Championship?
Pass.
Matt O'Reilly signed for Celtic from which club?
MK Dons.
Name any of the two Scotsmen currently managing in the English Championship.
Alex Neil.
Before Stephen Maclean, who was the last manager to lose their job in the Scottish Premiership?
Pass.
Who used to play their home games at Muirton Park?
Pass.
James, what do you think?
I think I've done okay. Could have been better.
Yeah, let's find out. I had to just think on my feet there. I'll explain why I gave the guys an extra question, but Charlie's fair and he won't hold it against me. The only Scot to score in the 2-2 draw between Hibs and Ross County last night was Jordan White. You both got it. At which team are currently bottom of the Championship? George Bowie's team.
Oh, Morton.
Morton are bottom. There was a question there about Stephen Davis, but he's not in the Rangers squad anymore, of course. So I kind of had to take it out after I'd said it. Matt O'Reilly signed from MK Dons, so you both got it. Name any of the two Scots currently managing in the English Championship: Alex Neil or Russell Martin. And is that a great thought process here, because you were down seeing Russell Martin recently, weren't you?
Yes.
So I thought, I'm annoyed at that. He's getting an advantage. He's going to say Russell Martin, and then you didn't. You went for Alex Neil. So fair enough. 3-2 to Charlie. Before Stephen Maclean, who was the last manager to lose their job in the Scottish Premiership?
Michael Beale.
Certain Mr. Michael Beale. And who used to play their home games at Muirton Park?
St. It
was
Johnston.
St. Johnston. Back in the day, everything that was back in the day is remembered by Hugh Keevins, though, which means James and whoever was helping you in the background, which is fine. It was a 2 for you, but a 3 for Charlie Mulgrew. Well done, Charlie. Hard lines, guys.
Cheers, James.
Cheers, thank you.
Who is that in the background, mate? James? We need to give him a shout out after all the help he gave you.
He's called James as well.
James and James in Springburn. Thank you very much. There we go. I think I got that right. Was that a 3-2? I think it was. Editing the questions as we went. Anyway, right. Hold on. Producer's now going, was it not 3-3? Well, the guys didn't speak up. Do you think you got a third one, James? Have I done you?
No, I think we got the third one, the Michael Beale one. That was the third one.
Oh, you got Michael Beale. Right. I've been hard on the guys. Can't believe it.
It's a player.
Can't believe it. I did wonder, just had a little thought there. Right, what we're going to do here is go to the tiebreaker. So I'll ask a question, I'll get Charlie to write his answer down, and I'll then invite you two to give me your attempt, okay?
Right, cool.
Right, let's get the question up and running. How many goals have been scored in the Scottish Premiership this season? Simple, Charlie. Write it down before they've got time to Google it. How many goals have been scored in the Scottish Premiership this season? James and James, what are you going for?
Going to go for 113.
113. Charlie's gone 74. I know it's not a high scoring league, but come on, it's 142. You're halfway there. The guys have done you. Well done, James, on the line. There we go. Well done.
Cheers.
Well done, James.
There we go. There we go. Thank you very much to James and James winning in the end. Made a pig's ear of them, to be honest. But there we go. We move on, and tomorrow's Beat the Pundit will be better. I promise. Right. 01419511025 is the number that you need. And there's Twitter as well at Clyde SSB. So don't forget, we're looking at the team news from tonight. We're building up to the games. See, everyone's tweeting me saying Leon Balogun's in his second spell at Rangers, so that would have been a good question. Yeah, but on my answer sheet it only said Stephen Davis. So heads will roll for this, don't you worry. It's Hugh Keevan's fault, and I will make sure he pays the price. But don't worry, tomorrow will be better, I think. Anyway, we are building up to those games. I was going to say we're 35 minutes away, but we're not at the Scott Foam Stadium at Dens Park, remember. That kickoff's been pushed back to about 8:05 as things stand.
How much does that affect your preparation, Charlie? I mean, you're literally climbing off the bus and getting out on the park now.
Presumably they won't be though, eh? That'll be why.
But you're still not
getting anything. Once
you're
on the bus,
right,
you've had your pre-match meal, you're ready to go for the game, and it's always like a strict pre-match meal, 3 hours and 15 minutes, I think the time is now, the sports science say.
So is it?
3 hours and 15 minutes it is now. It used to be 3 hours. Now it's 3:15.
Right.
So they'll have had something to eat, they'll be ready to go, and then now they'll probably have something else, probably a banana or something before.
The bus will be 20 minutes later, hence why kick something like that.
See, the more I think about it now, right, see the emphasis and the stuff you get stuck up on as a player. Like, I mean, the difference in 20 minutes isn't going to make a deal, but see, because you're that focused on every single thing being bang on in the build up to the game. You really start to think about these things, and you think, right, I'm going to eat a banana then, and that'll leave me that time to digest it before then we go and do a warm-up.
Is this now in retirement you've started thinking, I was so stressed out by all this stuff?
So much fear and stress, it's unbelievable.
But do you think everybody does though?
Yeah, I think they do.
Really?
I think it's a big motivation for me to go into management, because I want to have a team that are on the pitch and they don't feel that stress. Now listen, I'm not saying I can completely take that away, but what I think I can bring is a responsibility, a team knowing exactly what their jobs is on the pitch, and that can help with that kind of stuff. But I'm realising now that the weekends are coming and there's a bit of time for me to relax, whereas before a Friday would come and I'd think, oh, here we go, it's work time. Saturday morning would come, you get the feeling in your pit, your stomach the minute you wake up.
So even after all those games, you still felt stressed or pressurised?
You were institutionalised into that way of thinking, and no matter where you played or what competition you played in, you still wanted to perform and compete at the best level you can, no matter, I mean, whatever fans, a group of fans you played under demanded that you played the best form of yourself. So it was a lot of pressure, and that was a big reason why I didn't sign for Partick Thistle in the end, potentially to go there, and I decided that my motivation was outweighed by the stress and the fear and the anxiety that build up to games.
There you go.
I'm just thinking about the dietary routine.
You'd be hopeless.
I'm thinking that the Super Scoreboard team on a Saturday, I mean, when is Gordon DL to have his last Empire biscuit before we go on?
He's intermittent fasting now, of course. It's hard to keep up with him.
And Mark Wilson likes his chocolate as well.
Do you know what he sometimes eats, if you ever heard this before, if he's coming to do the show and he needs a snack in the afternoon?
Let's hear it.
Tell him.
Go on then, you tell.
A tin of cold beans.
No way.
How outrageous is that?
Tin of cold, right out the tin with a spoon?
Yeah.
How bad's that?
Hugh, that's not right. That's just not right. That's making me sick.
It's ludicrous, isn't it?
That's horrendous.
That was a war baby. What are you talking about?
What was his other thing?
But you've got, why can you just heat them?
What was his other thing? Crisps and mayonnaise was your other thing, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Jesus, Hugh. Imagine that for pre-match meal. Imagine cheese and onion your first 10 minutes.
Imagine sitting next to him after having to do the show. That's what you've got to worry about.
But I am the age for a chief executive, not a player.
Yeah.
I'm management.
Yeah. You took that stuff serious, didn't you? Did you not go veggie or vegan
or
something
vegan
for a while?
About 2 years.
2 years you lasted
But I didn't do it like 100% vegan.
Was that with a view to prolonging your career?
A bit of that in it, and a bit of just trying something out. And there was some, I learned a lot for it. There's still some, a lot of health benefits for you upping your veg intake and maybe not eating as much protein,
but no tins of cold beans. You drew the line there.
No tins of cold, they would have fitted right in with the diet though. They're vegan, tins of cold beans. But I played with a boy called Paul Caddis, who played with Celtic and that. He was at Blackburn when we started it, and he decided he's going to start it, but he's got quite an addictive personality, Paul Caddis, and he started, he got addicted to pieces and jam. So he was eating them for breakfast, lunch and dinner.
Technically,
just a loaf of jam. It's vegan.
It's vegan.
Aye.
It's not really what people have in mind when they go for that vegan diet, is it?
He forgot he doesn't like vegetables, so he went vegan and just didn't eat vegetables. So he was basically just eating anything other than vegetables that wasn't produced by an animal. So you can imagine
chocolate?
What he was eating.
So he always...
Do you eat chocolate?
No, I'm not vegan anymore, but I'll eat chocolate. Now I eat chocolate, I definitely.
So he always just pieces and jam?
Pieces and jam and grapes for his breakfast, and then
he's weirder than me.
Yeah.
I sometimes forget how we started this stuff. We're going to speak to Justin in a second. Let's get a bit more team news quickly. I'm sure Justin won't mind, because Dave Galloway has made it down to North Lanarkshire for Motherwell against Aberdeen.
Yeah, both teams will feel they have something to prove this evening, Gordon, and both could really do with a victory here. Motherwell, after four successive defeats, battled back impressively with two late goals to secure a draw against Ross County at the weekend. They showed very good effort and desire, although Stuart Kettlewell was frustrated with the team's overall performance. Aberdeen sits second bottom of the Premiership following a terrible display in Sunday's defeat to Kilmarnock, which again incurred the fury of fans already angry after a late collapse at home to Pauk, losing 3-2 after being 2-0 ahead with 17 minutes to go. The pressure's on then for Barry Robson and his team. All in all, it's been a poor season so far, and a massive week lies ahead with a cup semi-final against Hibs and an away game with Pauk coming up. To the teams then, and a couple of changes to tell you about for Motherwell. Lennon Miller and Connor Wilkinson are in for Ollie Shaw and Theo Baer. So it's Liam Kelly in goals, a back three of Paul McGinn, Bevis Mugabe and Dan Casey. Across the middle, Stephen O'Donnell, Harry Payton, Lennon Miller and Brody Spencer. In attack, Callum Slattery, Blair Spittle and Connor Wilkinson. The subs for the Steelmen tonight: Oxborough, Ghent, Baer, Zdravkovsky, Shaw, Blaney, Beerith, Ross and Butcher. A couple of changes also for Aberdeen: Leighton Clarkson and Dante Polvara are in, out of the starting lineup. Drop Connor Barron and Duke. It looks like it could well be a 5-4-1 tonight for them. Keller Roos in goals at the back, Nicky Devlin, Stefan Gartenman, Slobodan Rubicic, Richard Jensen and Jack McKenzie in the middle. Dante Polvara, Graham Shinney, Leighton Clarkson and Jamie McGrath, with Bojan Majovski ploughing a lone furrow up front. The subs: Doohan, Barron, Duke, Gay, Hayes, Sockler, Duncan, McDonald and Milne. Your match referee tonight at Fir Park. The pitch is looking magnificent, by the way. Conditions perfect. It's Colin Stephen with VAR. It's Don Robertson tonight.
Dave, I know you've got your finger on the pulse with the feelings amongst the Red Army. Could Barry Robson be doing with something tonight?
I really do think so. I mean, this week could go one of two ways. Aberdeen could get a win tonight and a win on Saturday, and everything in the garden suddenly is rosy again. You know, dreadful, dreadful performance against Kilmarnock. The pressure, was ratcheted up a bit because of that. And, you know, one of the worst Aberdeen performances I've seen in years, it has to be said. 83 minutes to get an effort on target, and that was their only effort on target. So the pressure is on Barry Robson, no doubt about it. And if they were to lose tonight and then get put out of the cup on Saturday, the feeling is that, you know, he could be clinging on by his fingertips.
Well, we will see what happens there. Justin, I know you'll forgive me for this, because you'll be interested in the update, but just quickly, Gabriel, are we looking at potentially a further delay at the Scott Foam Stadium at Dens Park?
Yes, we are, Gordon. Rangers still not arrived here. Their team bus stuck in traffic. Many supporters as well. We've just had an announcement here at Dens saying it's going to be delayed. Still no confirmation, but we're hearing that it may be as late as 8:30. That would be a 45-minute delay. Think of all the poor journalists, Gordon, sitting here in the cold.
Oh, yeah.
Think of them.
Heart bleeds for you. And actually, I'm getting unconfirmed reports that the team bus has actually stopped off at the petrol station in the Kingsway for a batch of cold
bananas.
Beans. to get them through to the build up. So we'll see. Justin, sorry about that, but I know you'll have wanted to hear the update on your team. When they eventually do get there, Justin, and you see Dessers not take to the pitch for the start, and Danilo on, what do you make of the team tonight?
A lot better. I just wish very briefly that you guys would stop talking about food. I'm stuck in the motorway as well. And I'm starving. I feel as if I'm sitting next to this girl on the motorway that long. I feel as if I'm on a date with her.
Would you eat a tin of cold beans?
I would be all over a can of cold beans and I'm that hungry. I'm starving.
Justin, starving. On the off chance, I'm going to regret this. I was going to say, in the off chance that the lady driver next to you is listening, you could get a message across. This could be the start of something.
I hope she's not, because she's about 20 years older than me, but that's not a bad thing.
Right, I think we definitely move on before we get in trouble. Anyway, beans and motorway dating aside, what are you thinking tonight?
Really happy that he's decided to put Danilo in. And that was going to be my question. Predominantly Charlie, but I'd be keen to see what you think as well. Charlie, as a defender, playing as a defender, who would you... Which one, Dessers or Danilo, would you least like to go up against? The reason I ask the question is I think we've all seen what Dessers has to offer. His first touch doesn't seem to be great. He seems cumbersome and slow and a bit pedestrian. Danilo seems to me, I know one of your callers earlier on kind of likened him to Fashion, but I think he's more kind of cross between Fashion and Alfie. And the fact that he seems to have a kind of low centre of gravity, but a lot more pace.
Yeah, I think...
I was just keen to see what you thought, what one you would...
I would least like to play against Danilo, no doubt about it. I think the little flashes I've saw him in, he seems to like to peel off the back of defenders and make himself elusive in the box. So that's one thing as a defender, when you're trying to keep your eye on the ball and you're also trying to keep one eye on the player and have him in touching distance. If a clever striker's good enough, he can get in behind you. You've seen for the goal he scored at McDermott Park, and then the header he scored when he hurt his cheek, and then the goal he scored the winner against Hearts. Both times he peels off the back of the defender, and it's really, really hard to deal with because the player gets a jump on you, and I'm sure that he's going to score a lot of goals for Rangers just by seeing these small bits of movement, because sometimes when you see somebody peeling off the back of you and you turn to look at them, then they all of a sudden they shoot across the front. And these strikers are hard to pick up. Whereas with Dessers, he seems a bit, as you say, a bit cumbersome, a bit slow to react, a bit his touch isn't kind of quite there. Danilo definitely wouldn't want to play against Danilo.
The choice tonight has to be self-explanatory. Danilo comes on, scores the winner Sunday against Hearts, and you know he's clearly a brave man. You know, he scored the goal at St Johnstone, got himself a real nasty injury as a consequence, but gets over it, wants back straight away, gets the mask on, scores a vital goal. Dessers just can't do right for doing wrong. So the choice is obvious for the manager tonight.
Can it sometimes flip the sort of pressure of it as well? Because I'm sure Philippe Clement has still said that Danilo's maybe not ready for 90 minutes. So you'd imagine you see Dessers at some point tonight. Is that a different type of pressure when you can, well, maybe not if it's, you know, if it's 0-0 and he has to come on and win it, but you know, that not having to carry the burden from the beginning, sometimes it's different.
Yeah, I think you're bang on. I think that he'll be on the bench tonight. He'll be annoyed, he'll be disappointed, you'd imagine he would be, and he'll be looking to prove a point. So he'll be known, he'll come on at some stage, and it's up to him to come on. And you're right, there is less pressure of being Rangers. He's number nine, and the pressure's on to score goals. Sometimes when you put too much pressure on yourself, as Hugh said, you can't do right for doing wrong. Every single time you seem to be in the wrong position, your touch seems to be slightly off. So maybe coming on tonight, if Rangers get a couple of goals up, he might come on and play a lot more freer, or he might even come on and see a better side of him.
Justin, it was a good question. Thank you very much. We'll take more of your calls next.
taking your calls on Scottish football. 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Hugh Keevins and Charlie Mulgrew are here. We've got a busy night, so I'm not going to dwell on this too long, but let's give you your full-time teaser anyway.
The full-time teaser with Sliding Wardrobe Solutions East Kilbride. Slat wall panels available in 7 colours. Now in stock at East Kilbride at competitive prices.
Thanks to Lawrence and Lanark, only 5 answers to this. And it's a bit different. It's not a Scottish football question as such. Can you name 5 players that have won the Ballon d'Or, the World Cup and the Champions League since 1998?
Messi.
I heard he's quite good. Any others, Charlie?
Zidane.
Yeah, alright, we'll leave it there. He's going to be very straightforward tonight. I think you'll absolutely skish it. Should be absolutely fine indeed. Right, we've given you team news, obviously, from Dundee, from Celtic, from Fir Park as well. Let's just quickly touch on the scenario at St Johnstone, because it is an important night. It's always a big deal when we get a managerial vacancy in the Scottish Premiership. It has made a couple of changes. Alec Cleland is the one in interim charge. People like Ryan McGowan brought back into the team. Not seen much of him from the beginning recently. So he's in. I think it was 3 or 4 changes in total as they get ready to take on Kilmarnock tonight. Charlie Mulgrew, you are a aspiring coach. Assuming you see a vacancy like the St Johnstone one, is that something you're interested in? What do you do in that scenario?
Definitely. You just try and get your CV in there somehow, and hopefully that you can get a chance to speak to them and give your ideas across, and hopefully somebody takes a chance in you. Listen, I know that I'm not experienced. I'm not daft enough to think that I've got the experience and I've got all the answers, but I do have clear ideas and how I see the game. I've got a lot of experience in football without it being in a manager's role, and I feel I've got a lot to give, but I do understand that there is candidates in there that will be experienced.
So that in particular is one that would appeal to you to try and give it a go?
Yeah, it definitely will. It definitely would. I feel that there's a good squad there. There's players that can be worked with. I think throughout my career, I've always had good relationships with players and staff, and I feel that knowing a couple of the players, Nicky Clark, Andy Constein, Ryan McGowan, Graham Carey, who I know a time at Celtic, I feel that you could get your message across to these players because they're good players and good professionals.
Do you feel there have been opportunities for young coaches in recent times, you know, to get that first job? A lot of the appointments have come internally.
Yeah.
See if some of them don't work. Do you feel like that goes against you? Now, I know everybody's different, but you know what it's like? People just start broad brushing everybody.
Understand.
And I've seen people saying recently that, oh, you know, maybe it's going to be back to the turn of the experienced manager. These sort of thoughts.
Yeah, these thoughts do go through your mind, but I bring it back to my thoughts I was speaking about earlier, that when they talk about old school managers and they talk about more experienced managers, if these managers have had success in their career, it's through managing players. Now, when the young managers comes in, there's a new way of kind of speaking about tactics and philosophies that you never heard that a few years ago. And I think if you can combine both of the things, where is people management and any walk of life is important, and also have a clear philosophy and a clear way of style in which you see the game, then if you can get this message across, which is a challenging thing, but then I think that's what would make the ideal manager. But in terms of waves of managers, you do think about it. You do think, are you going to get a chance? But you've just got to believe in what you're going to teach, and hopefully an opportunity comes up.
The thing about St Johnstone, they're bottom, but they're only 4 points away from Aberdeen.
Five.
So a couple of results in this league, positive results, will take you up to a very high place and stop people talking about you as relegation fodder. So
that probably has to happen quite soon, doesn't it? Just as Dave Galloway was talking about how quickly things can change.
I think when we focus a lot on results, right? And of course that's the way St Johnstone need results, there's no doubt about that. But I think there needs to be a style of play and a clear way in which you play in, and then the players can focus on that. Because if you start chasing results, it brings an enormous amount of stress towards you, and all of a sudden you maybe go 1-0 up in a game, you think, oh, we need to sit back and hold on to this. Or you go 1-0 down, you think, we can't really score. Whereas if you've got a clear style in how you want to play, regardless of what the score is, and you focus on that, then results come along the way, I think.
Let's park that one for now. Rangers have arrived 5 minutes ago, I believe. Any update, Gabriel?
No, as you said, Gordon, Rangers arrived 5 minutes ago. Still waiting for that confirmed kickoff time, although with them only arriving now at 7:30, it looks like 8:30 is a more likely kickoff time. I will let you know as soon as we get that officially confirmed.
Sore one for the fans and the journalists who need to get back to Glasgow at 2 in the morning. Let's bring in Graham, who's on the line. Graham, not ideal, I don't suppose, but have any impact in the game tonight for you?
No, I don't think so. I think they're professional enough, aren't they?
I'd like to think so.
I'd like to think so. Well, having seen that, watching Dessers and Lammers recently, don't know.
Well, you only have to watch one of them from the start tonight, of course.
I know. What you got on eye, I think.
So very quickly, actually, it has been confirmed now, 8:30. Rangers have just this second confirmed it. Sorry, on you go, Graham.
It's just a point to Charlie. Charlie,
yes.
As a player,
yep.
Seeing you're going through what these two boys are going through.
Who's that?
Dessers and Lammers.
Dessers and Lammers. Yes.
Think it'd be kinder to take the boys out there, take them out, it's all together. It can be pleasant going to work every Saturday and going through that.
I know it's horrible. I've been there myself more than one occasion. It really is horrible. Fair play to them to continue to be there and put the jersey on, because they must be feeling low in confidence, and you're right, maybe that is a bit of man management. You need to take them out and have a word with them and say to them, I'm going to take you out for a few weeks. I remember it happened to me at Celtic when I first went back there, and we played against Braga in a Champions League qualifier at home, and honest to God, it could not have went any worse. I remember
laughing at your misfortune.
No, you can laugh now, but honestly, it was far from laughing at the time. I remember the ball was going out for a throw-in for us, and I tried to stop it, to keep it in at the last minute. I don't know, my foot, and I gave him a throw-in inside our half. You know what I mean? It was just, you just see when you're feeling that low in confidence, everything just goes against you, and it's a horrible place to be. And Neil Lennon did, he took me out of the team, he brought Amelia Zagarian at the time, and he said, listen, we've got your back, we'll stand by you, we're just bringing you out of the team for a wee while, and you can work your way back in, and then you work your way back into training and get your confidence up, and then you need to be ready for the next time you come in. The next time you come in, you know you need to perform. But you're right there, Graham. Maybe a couple of weeks the team would do them a world of good.
Yeah, Graham, one of the changes has been made tonight. You're looking forward to seeing Danilo from the start. Leon Balogun's in at the back. We've not really spoken much about that. Is there anything about this fixture that still, you know, does it worry you at all tonight? Do you think Rangers are that much better under Philippe Clement, or is there still a concern going into games like this?
Still a concern, mate. The first hour against Hearts, it was that Michael Beale performance with a different manager, and it's an away game in Dalby. The weather's no, everything's going against them, getting there late. I don't know. It's just, you just hope for the best, but the performance, some of the performance the other day against Hearts was just a Michael Beale performance for most of it.
I think for someone like Sam Lammers, Hugh, that if Rangers fans have got any patience left, it will clearly be diminishing, and I can, it doesn't always work out this way. A guy might score a hat-trick tonight and people will phone in tomorrow. Yeah. But you can sense where Graham's coming from. This is a guy who really hasn't performed, so he's probably low in confidence. He's gone up to Dens Park, it's pouring a rain, kick-off's delayed 45 minutes. It's got all the ingredients for a tough night, but again,
two tins of beans in him.
I know, exactly.
But as you say, that sometimes under these extraordinary circumstances, strange things can happen. He might have his best game in the Rangers jersey, or he might be an unqualified disaster and have to be brought off. But he has not kicked a ball since he signed for Rangers. And I laughed about it earlier on, but we do have the proverbial wet night in Dundee, and he'll just have to rise to the occasion. But I'm wondering about the effect of all of this on the Dundee players, because they were ready for a 7:45 kickoff, and now they're
three tins
drumming their fingers in the dressing room or whatever it is you do.
That's just one too many. I do like this from David Ashcroft. I always like it when fans have a sense of humour on the news that Rangers game against Dundee has been delayed. David says, at this rate we won't get our penalty until Thursday. There he goes. Good time to take breath for us, I think. Thank you, Graham, because we'll go back around the grounds ahead of kickoff next.
For football in Glasgow and the West.
0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Fast approaching some of the kickoffs. There has been that lengthy delay at Dens Park, so we'll get to that in the near future. We're going to go back to Celtic Park in just a second. Very quickly, we're looking for five players who've won the Ballon d'Or, the World Cup and the Champions League since 1998. Not a bad CV. Lionel Messi and Zinedine Zidane so far. So that's the level of company you need to be keeping.
Iniesta?
No.
Xavi?
No.
They've not won it.
I bet you they came like second and third, probably in Ballon d'Or, but they were in the old Messi and Ronaldo era, weren't they? I reckon you've played.
No.
I reckon you'll have played against two of these. I'm trying to think. You're Celtic. No, maybe you came slightly after. No, I'm just confusing things. Yeah, maybe I'm talking nonsense.
Ronaldinho?
Yes. Did play against them?
Didn't play against them, but.
Right, okay.
I reckon that's who you're on.
There we go. Okay, two to get. We'll try and get them before the end of the show. Let's go back to Celtic Park ahead of kickoff. What's the atmosphere like, Andrew? I generally hate that question, but I think it's obviously relevant given what's going on with the Green Brigade this week.
Yeah, it definitely is relevant. I mean, Celtic Park isn't as busy as it normally is. That is, you know, a range of factors. It's a midweek game. It's this time of year. The weather conditions are horrible as well. But as you mentioned, there is that ban on the Green Brigade from Celtic. There are still some fans in that sort of North Curve section, as it's only officially registered members that have been banned. So there are some other people that do sit in that section. But, you know, the whole of the Green Brigade won't be here because they'll obviously stand in solidarity with the ones that have been officially banned. But it is a lot more sparse than normal. You can see that there are still a few Palestine flags in there being held up by some of the fans that are in that section. So it is maybe a bit of a quieter atmosphere at the moment at Celtic Park. As I say, there are a range of factors, but the teams are just about to make their way out the tunnel, so the noise will pick up a bit here as well. And as we focus on the football, Celtic looking to continue that unbeaten start to the Premiership campaign. They'll be looking to up the tempo really from the weekend, where it was a bit flat against Hibs, and, you know, up against a stubborn St Mirren side as well, who they're always very well organised, aren't they, under Stephen Robinson. You'd expect that again tonight. And with the changes they've made as well, they were looking to utilise that pace on the counter-attack that they've got, with the likes of Conor McMenamin, with the likes of Toyosi Olasanya as well. So that will be their game plan, and we'll wait and see how Celtic can handle it. Will they be as up for it as they were last Wednesday at the game against Atletico Madrid, where they were absolutely fantastic in that game? If we take a look at the team news as the players shake hands, there are three changes for Celtic. Out go Nat Phillips coming in for him, Paolo Bernardo and Dyson Maida are in. It's Turnbull and Forrest, of course, that are in, as well as Nat Phillips. Cameron Carter-Vickers, Bernardo and Maida are the three that are out. Just on Cameron Carter-Vickers, it was a surprise that he isn't in the starting lineup tonight. Brendan Rodgers has been asked about that pre-match. He said it was always the plan to bring him out for this game. He's working his way back from a knee injury at the moment, and the plan was to give him a bit of rest in this game tonight, and he should be back ready for the weekend and beyond. So the starting lineup tonight: Joe Hart in goal, Alistair Johnson, Nat Phillips, Liam Scales and Greg Taylor the back four, Callum McGregor, David Turnbull and Matt O'Reilly are the midfield three, with James Forrest and Lewis Palmer either side of Kyogo. As for St Mirren, they've also made three changes. Ryan Flynn is out, Keanu Backus is out as well. That's a big loss for them, and Mikael Mandron drops to the bench as well. Despite scoring a couple of goals at the weekend, in come Ryan Strain, who is a huge player for St Mirren, week in, week out. Caelan Boyd-Munce and Toyosi Olasanya are in as well. So Zach Henning in goal for them, the back three: Marcus Fraser, Alex Gogic and Richard Taylor. Ryan Strain and Scott Tanzer, the two wing-backs, with Caelan Boyd-Munce and Mark O'Hara the two central midfielders. Conor McMenamin and Greg Kilty are the supporting party for Toyosi Olasanya up top. A cheer going around Celtic Park there as the players break away from their huddle. The referee for this one at Celtic Park is John Beaton. The VAR is Nick Walsh, and St Mirren have got us underway.
And there we are. Go on then. You got one right. You're dined out on it all week. You finally got a score prediction right. You felt Celtic would be held at the weekend. What are you thinking tonight?
I'm thinking there'll be another 2 points dropped.
Dropped two games in a row. Wow.
Yeah.
Charlie?
2-0 Celtic.
There we go. Routine. We can get to the Rangers prediction in a little while. How is Aberdeen Motherwell going to Motherwell Aberdeen, I should say.
It's interesting. Dave Galloway saying that if Motherwell were to beat Aberdeen tonight and Aberdeen went out of the Viaplay Cup at the semi-final stage to Hibs on Saturday evening, then Barry Robson could be under pressure. I don't know that you can go from what Dave described as the worst performance for many a day on Sunday at Kilmarnock to beating Motherwell at home. I fancy Motherwell.
Motherwell kind of struggling a bit though, Charlie. Psychologically, I'm sure a huge lift coming down, coming back from 3-1 down with minutes to go to draw 3-3, but still a fairly long winless run at the moment.
Yeah, they are. Aberdeen need a response after their performance at Kilmarnock, so I'm going to say it'll be a draw that game.
Draw in that one. How much, this might be lazy on my part, how much can we lump Barry Robson, Stephen Naismith in together in the rookie manager type, at a big club type, could be doing with a win type? You're shaking your head at me.
No, I don't like that because they're two young managers.
No, I actually mean both, mostly based on the fact that they're at big clubs and they need a win.
Yeah. They're both at big clubs and they need a win. But I think you have to look at how are both teams playing? What's their style of play? Are they unlucky with results? When I look at Aberdeen at the weekend, they were just lumping it forward to two big strikers with absolutely no idea where to go after that, which was, for me, was slightly worrying. You couldn't see a style, you couldn't see a way of playing.
You touched on it earlier, Gordon, the concept of in-house appointments. It can work.
Shot of the bar there from Luis Palma, just cutting on his right, sorry, Hugh.
Barry Robson and Stephen Naismith, both in-house appointments, but neither pulling up any trees at the moment. And I don't think it's, Hearts haven't happened overnight. The last days of Robbie Nielsen were really poor, and the club hasn't kicked on at all since then. Aberdeen, for their part, have only risen to the occasion once this season domestically, and that was at Ibrox, and it was enough to cost Michael Beale's job. They are both toiling, and we've got rid of seven managers this season already. One quarter of the Premiership have get rid of their manager, and the words Sugarly Nail and Jackets come to mind.
Speaking of which, there's also a type of fixture that you don't get much forgiveness. Livingston coming to Tynecastle with that big expectant crowd would be that, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
That's not the type of result that if Hearts don't win it, the fans will say, oh well, always next time, that was going to be a tricky game. It just doesn't fall into that category.
Well, Livy themselves have wobbled a bit, but I do appreciate why you framed the question that way. They can be a pest, and if they are a pest for Stephen Naismith tonight, then it could set a very difficult tone about the place with the cup semi-final against Rangers, your next match.
See Hearts doing it though tonight.
They need to get a result. Again, I'm not really sure in what their style of play is and what they're trying to do. I watched them against Celtic and they get rolled over. He wasn't too happy with things. I've heard Stephen Naismith mention a couple of times individual errors. So they'll need to get a result tonight. The thing about it is if you don't have a clear way in what you're doing, even if you do get a result, then what do you do next game? You just go and roll the dice again? I don't know. I mean, they need a result. The fans will be demanding a win tonight, so it's a big game for Hearts.
St Johnstone have scored a grand total of 3 goals this season in 9 games until now. 2 minutes in, Alec Cleland is a magician, and Nicky Clark has them in front against Kilmarnock.
Nicky Clark, he's scored wherever he's been, handy man to have. You wonder if Stephen Maclean's approach to management, where on more than one occasion this season he absolutely slaughtered players, no earlier than last Saturday he accused them of chucking it.
Twice in 9 games was quite a ratio.
As Hugh, go and finish your point.
Now. I wonder if the players are getting a bounce from not having the manager.
Well, Nicky Clark's been injured. His first game back was at the weekend, and then he's back in tonight. He's a big player. I played with him at Dundee United. He's a player that they signed last year. He's a big player that Steve McLean never had at his disposal. So
Bit of a change to Rangers' pre-match preparation. The game has been delayed until 8:30, 45 minutes later than it should have been. Speaking of preparation, there's been a lot said about Rangers' fitness and so on from Philippe Clement. He's been really big on it. There's only one man in here who knows what a cryo chamber is or has ever seen one, I suspect. I did want to get your thoughts on this because he's been really specific about some of his complaints, and he says they've got this cryo chamber at the training ground and the players don't even use it, or few of them do, and he wants them to live a bit better, I think, be a bit more of a professional. Does he have a point, or what's the script with that stuff?
Well, first of all, I've got a quick story on a cryo chamber. When I was at Fleetwood, we had a cryo chamber, and I didn't have one at Blackburn. Surprisingly, Fleetwood had one, so the owner had invested in a cryo chamber. And I used it. So my first game for Fleetwood, I went in, first time I'd ever been in one. Went in, you wear the Crocs, you wear the hats, you wear the gloves, and I forgot to wear my socks. So I've stood up the back of the chamber because there was three or four A's in it, and where the stuff comes out, obviously the stuff that makes it freezing, is blown right against my heels for the full 3 minutes. So I woke up the next morning, I'm no joking, Gordon, I couldn't walk. Couldn't put shoes on.
The blisters stuff meant to be good for you.
The blisters in the back of my heels through ice buns were unbelievable. So I'm like, how am I going to phone the manager and say I've got blisters, I can't walk? So I've got a hold of the physios and I says, you're not going to believe me here. I told them the story and they're laughing like anything. Like, you're joking. So I turned up at the game with flip flops. Long story short, I get painkilling injection in my heels in order to get my boots on. So I get painkilling injections, cortisone injections in my heels, waited for them to kick in, put my boots on, done the warm up and played the game. I'm no joking, with 10 minutes to go, you should have seen me running. Thankfully we won the game, we were quite comfortable at that point, but you should have seen me. I couldn't move, there was blood on my socks, it was absolutely hanging.
Philippe Clement, if you're listening,
get the socks on.
Don't force your players into that cryo chamber. There's been a goal at Celtic Park already, and it's for St Mirren. Connor McMenamin header from Greg Kilty cross. I didn't disagree, I'm just making
sure.
Long
way to go, Hugh.
Well, you're 2-0 out the window, I'll tell you that much.
Ah, it's gone.
Give St Mirren something to hold on to, Hugh. And I don't know if they're the team you want to give something to hold on to.
They came full of confidence, and they have justified their pre-match confidence. And Celtic, on a day when internal warfare broke out with a vengeance regarding the Green Brigade and the club, the atmosphere at Celtic now is difficult. A massive distraction has been created. And, you know, Celtic struggled to score, obviously, at Easter Road at the weekend. And now they need two for the full 3 points.
A bit of a frustration for the Celtic defence. I'm sure there's been a change there, of course. It's different. It's Phillips and Scales tonight. And Conor McMenamin's a tricky winger, if you like. You know, he's got in between the two centre-backs. It's a free header, so I'm sure Brendan Rodgers won't want to... or certainly won't like what he's witnessed there on that one. But we are almost out of time. Whatever does happen in the remainder of that game, we will look back on, of course, tomorrow. Is there a shock on the cards? Certainly, we've got one underway. And we've no idea. St Johnstone are 2-0 up on Kilmarnock after 7 minutes. Remarkable stuff in that one. And a delayed kickoff, remember, at Dens Park. So we've got a bit of time to go there. So quickly on the teaser, two more players who've won the World Cup, the Ballon d'Or and the Champions League since 98. You've got Zidane, Ronaldinho and Messi. Don't let your silence.
Roberto Carlos.
No, but he is Brazilian. So around that era, R9. Then it was Ronaldinho, who was kind of in the middle. He played with R9. Similar sounding name to Ronaldo. Change a couple of letters in the middle. Oh, God. This is like Countdown. Rivaldo.
Rivaldo. Oh.
And the other guy, another Brazilian. I thought you might have played against him, but I'm thinking maybe before your Celtic time. AC Milan.
Cafu?
No, midfielder.
Oh, Kaka.
Kaka, thank you very much. What a night we've got in store. We'll look back on it all tomorrow with Gordon DL and Mark Wilson. Callum Gallagher is up next.